A very good morning to the students of class 7. Welcome everyone to our social science class. Yes, Oyantik, the chapter number 4 history and chapter number 5 geography question answers. Yes, it was uploaded because I sent this. So within a couple of hours, it will be visible to you. Okay, so we'll check that. So now today we're going to discuss the another subunit from your history chapter 5. It is why were temples destroyed? Another one, it is the building temples, mosques and tanks. Okay, building temples, mosques and tanks, and why were temples destroyed? So at that time, why did the king build temples, mosques and tanks? The temples and mosques are beautifully constructed because they were places of worship, and it is page number 63 and 64 of your book, history book, chapter number 5. The temples and mosques were beautifully constructed because of the places of worship, and they were also meant to demonstrate their power, wealth and also the devotion towards their patron, such as the Rajarajeshwara temple built by Rajaraja Chola. So the establishment of that temple actually showcased the power as well as the devotion of King Rajaraja Chola towards the King Rajarajeshwara. It is a Shiva idol. Okay. So an inscription mentions that it was built by Rajaraja Deva, and it is also another significance. In this way, they showcased that the god Rajarajeshwaram and the king was actually very similar, because they often acquired the name of the god, such as the name of the god is Rajarajeshwaram, the idol of the Shiva, and the name of the king also Rajaraja Chola. So in this way, they showcased that they were very much similar towards to the god, and the king took the god's name because it auspicious and he wanted to appear like a god. So through the rituals of worship in the temple, one god, Rajaraja Deva, honored another. It is Rajarajeshwaram. So this is also showcased that one god means the king giving respect to another god. So the largest temples at the time were constructed by the king. The other, the lesser deities also placed in the temple, and were gods and goddesses of the allies and subordinates of the ruler. So not only he placed the main deity worshipped by him, he also placed the deities of their allies and subordinates in the temple. These are lesser deities also placed in some small other syrens. And actually in this way, the temple was a miniature model of the world ruled by the king. Yes, Oyantik, not today. In the doubt clearing classes, I will discuss chapter wise and clear all your doubts, okay? So listen this subunit first. That they worship the deities together in a loyal temples. So in this way, in the temple, the architectures, the idols, they inscribed on the body of the temples, everything showcased the kingdom ruled by the king. And they worshipped the deities of their allies, means the deities also showcased that the king had good relationship with the other kings. Okay. And those deities also the subordinate of the main deity. So it in this way they showcased their political formation also through their temples. Okay. So it seemed as if they brought the just rule of the gods on earth. The Muslim sultans also, in the similar way, perhaps did not claim to be the incarnation of God, but Persian court chroniclers described them, the sultans, as a shadow of God. They are not directly mentioned as per their religion, but they mentioned them shadow of God. So an inscription in the Quwat al-Islam Mosque in New Delhi explained that God chose Alauddin Khalji as a king because he had the qualities of Moses and Solomon. So Moses was the founder of the religion, that is Judaism. And also it was mentioned in Holy Book Al-Quran that Moses is one of the important Nabi, appeared before the Muhammad. So, and Solomon was also mentioned as a king for and remembered for his remarkable administration and public welfare. So the great lawgivers of the past, Moses and Solomon, also compared here with the Alauddin Khilji. And the greatest lawgiver and architect was God himself. So the creator of the world created the world out of the chaos and introduced order and symphony. So that's why he sent those rulers. So it was mentioned in this way in the chronicles. All those chronicles written at that time, written by Minhaji Siraj, okay, and other rulers, other chroniclers described in the sultans in a manner like the representative of the god, a shadow of God. So as each new dynasty came to power, kings wanted to embrace their emphasize their moral right to be rulers, constructing places of worship provided rulers with the chance to proclaim their close relationship with the God. Students, the syllabus already mentioned in the e-portal, okay? You will check the e-portal and the chat box of the e-portal already mentioned, and I have mentioned several times. Check that and write in your copy. No, syllabus is already given there. You checked so many times I have given that. Okay. And
I have tried, but I cannot get the syllabus,
sir. In civics, you have to read up to chapter number 5. Okay, women change the world. And geography also, except the air chapter, water is included in your syllabus. Okay, only 4 chapters. 1, 2, 3, and 5. Okay. Not 4. Okay. Asibul understood? Okay. So now I'm again starting from that portion that especially important, the age of rapid political changes. The rulers has also patronage to the learned and pious and tried to transform their capitals and cities into great cultural centers that brought fame to their rule and their realm. So kings wanted to emphasize their moral rights to be the rulers. So that's why they're constructing the places of worship, provided rulers with the chance to proclaim their close relationship with the God. And sometimes they also transform their capitals and cities, and sometimes they're given the name of their capital on the name of God and goddesses. Okay, so it was widely believed that the rule of the king, it is page number 65. Okay. It was widely believed that the rule of a king just would be an age of plenty when the heavens would not withhold rain. So at the time, making precious water available by constructing tanks and reservoirs was highly praised. Okay, so it was believed that the god was very much happy with the king, so that's why the rainfall was never withheld. So that's why the kings, to represent this as a truth, so they dug a lot of reservoirs or tanks. Okay. In Bengali, it is called dighi also. Okay. So a lot of reservoirs, ponds, and water bodies dug by the rulers. So Sultan Iltutmish won universal respect for constructing a large reservoir just outside the Delhi Kuna. So, student, just a minute. Okay. So, the Delhi Kuna, outside Delhi Kuna, a large reservoir also constructed by the king Iltutmish. In the similar way, and the name of the reservoir is Hajj-i-Sultani. Okay, and the place of the Hajj-i-Sultani already mentioned in chapter 3, first page. Okay, in chapter 3, first page, in the map, when 7 cities mentioned, I have already mentioned, in that page you can found the place of Hajj-i-Sultani, the king's reservoir, meaning the king's reservoir. And can you, so the rulers often constructed tanks and reservoirs, big and small, for the use of the ordinary people, for public welfare. And sometimes these tanks and reservoirs were part of a temple, mosque, or a gurudwara. Okay, such as a small tank also situated beside the Jami Masjid in New Delhi. And a huge tank was constructed beside the Haramandir Sahib, or the Golden Temple in Amritsar. And the name of the pond is Amritsar. Okay, Sar means Sarobar. Okay, so Amrit Sarobar. Okay, so live classes, you can mention it in the e-portal, okay, to Arnav sir. And I will tell our principal sir to arrange some classes for you, okay. So I'll discuss about this matter later, about the live classes, okay. So now students, tell me if you have any doubt from this subunit. That king represent themselves as a, sometimes the Hindu kings represent themselves as a incarnation of the god, as a representative of the god, or very similar to the god. And the Islamic rulers, they mention them shadow of the god. And they established lots of temples, and sometimes they named their capital after the god and goddesses, and sometimes they dug a lot of tanks. Okay, this is the gist. Authentic Adil Shah. Adil Shah is the ruler of Sayyid dynasty, okay. A ruler of Sayyid dynasty, Adil Shah. The Adil Shah is the descendants of Sher Shah Suri, okay. Adil Shah is the descendant of Sher Shah Suri. So why were temples destroyed? Now next one, that because kings built temples and demonstrate their devotion to God and their power and wealth, so it is not surprising that when they attacked one another's kingdom, they often targeted these buildings. In the early 9th century, when the Pandyan king Sharimara Sharivallava Srimara Srivallava invaded Sri Lanka and defeated the chronicler Dhammakitti. He noted that he removed all the valuables. The statues of the Buddha made entirely of gold in the Jewel Palace, and the golden images in the various monasteries, all these he seized. So in this way, when they attacked in another king's kingdom, he actually tried to destroy the temples and the monasteries, all these things first, to curb the power of the king. And plundered is very common, such as Sultan Mahmud plundered the temples of Somnath temple several times. So blow the pride of the Sinhalese ruler had to be avenged, and the next Sinhalese ruler. So Sena too ordered his general to invade Madurai, the capital of the Pandyas, and the Buddhist chronicler noted that the expedition made a special effort to find and restore the gold statue of the Buddha. So when the Pandya king Srimara Srivallava plundered those golden statue and took it to the Madurai, the capital of Pandyas, then again the Sinhalese ruler Sena too, he led expedition to recover the golden Buddha. Okay, so in this way they both try to establish their domination, over each other through religion. Okay, similarly, in the early 17th century, when the Chola king Rajendra of Chola I built a Shiva temple in the capital, he filled it with the prized statues seized from defeated rulers and even from Bengal. The Bengali idols, the god and goddesses, also placed inside the temple built by Rajendra Chola I in Gangaikonda Cholapuram temple. An incomplete list included a sun pedestal from the Chalukyas, a Ganesha statue from several statues of Durga, a Nandi statue from the eastern Chalukyas, an image of Bhairava and Bhairavi from the Kalingas of Orissa, and Kali statue, a goddess Kali statue, also placed inside the Gangaikonda Cholapuram when he plundered Bengal and conquered Bengal. So in this way, those gods and goddesses from each of these provinces also showcased that the Rajendra Chola conquered and defeated the kings of that provinces. So how many provinces are there? Such as the Chalukya image, Chalukya ruled in the center, Maharashtra region today. Okay, statues of Durga and Ganesha, so from central India, that region. Images of Bhairava also there. And the Orissa and Bengal's deities also placed inside the temple. So this was shown that he plundered and conquered those regions. So Sultan Mahmud of Ghazni was a contemporary of Rajendra Chola I. Also during his campaigns, his subcontinent, he also attacked the temples of defeated kings and looted their wealth and idols. Sultan Mahmud was not a very important ruler at the time, but by destroying temples, especially the one at Somnath temple, he tried to win credit as a great hero of Islam. Okay. And in the political culture in the Middle Ages, most rulers displayed their political might and military success by attacking the opponent kings, temples and monasteries, and destroying them, looting them, and the places of worship of the defeated rulers. Okay, so this is a culture in the Middle Ages, mostly in the Middle East. So these rulers plundered their defeated kings' temples and destroyed them. So this is a culture also continued by Muhammad of Ghazni when they attacked the temple of Somnath. Okay, so students, if you have any doubt, you can tell me from these subunits. So Bhairava also the name of the Shiva mentioned here, a form of Shiva also called Bhairava. So in Bengali Satipits, that you can see that different Bhairavas placed with the goddess Bhairavi. Okay. Bhairavi actually the form of Durga, and it is a Bhairav, it is a form of Shiva. So in each Satipits, the 51 Satipits spread all over the Indian subcontinent and some other places also, so also contains these two deities. Okay. Okay, so I think you have understood that why did they plunder temples with the example of Mahmud, Rajendra Chola I, and also the example of Sena II, the Sinhalese ruler, and the Pandya king of Tamil Nadu, Srimara Srivallava. Okay, so that's all from today's class. So see you in the next class with another subunit.